Very briefly, I'll really like to congratulate Wish to have focused on primary healthcare. There are a lot of private and public initiatives, but most of them have been disease focused or life stage focused, maternal care or child care. Mr. Vadhwani said, that primary healthcare is the foundation, and therefore it's extremely, extremely important to make that a solid foundation of any healthcare system. Everything else falls in place if the base is strong. Multiple vertical interventions can do well and can be sustainable for a longer period of time. As far as the primary healthcare in India is concerned, I don't think we need to really mince much words about it. Most people in rural India, the healthcare is not available at the distance they can travel or at the cost they can afford or with the dignity that they deserve, which is fairly well reflected in high levels of mortality and the inequities in those mortality levels. I mean, just to give a small example, our infant mortality levels, for example, are almost 3-4 times higher than that of Thailand, which is a country which is one could, you know, kind of draw some similarities from. It's also one of the main causes of indebtedness. In Rajasthan, it's been shown again and again that it's one of the major causes of indebtedness in India. Largely, another thing that kind of depicts the dysfunctionality of primary healthcare system is the fact that most of the care seeking is largely from informal care providers for an outpatient. While for inpatient, it is still the public sector and also for preventive and promotive. But largely for outpatient, 70 to 80% of the care seeking is from informal private providers. That's shows the presence of primary healthcare services. We, of course, in the areas that we work, we often see delayed care seeking or no care seeking at all amongst the poorer families. They would continue. I mean, we've seen patients with tuberculosis suffering almost for a year before they seek any provider whatsoever because of the delay. Having said that, last 5-6 years, there has been some improvement in the primary healthcare systems with some provisions that have been positive, I mean, that which have formed some basis for strengthening primary healthcare system. For example, presence of this large community health worker force, presence of additional health workers, but all of them need to come together to lead to a stronger primary healthcare system.
Okay. Just for the audience benefit, if you can explain what you mean by informal private providers.
So the informal private providers are the providers who are not qualified by any system of medicine to practice medicine, but are often present in rural areas and provide primary care. And in absence of anything else, families do prefer seeking care. They are available, they are low cost, they are flexible. And a large number of first degree consultations continue to happen with them because they're closer home, they're cheaper.
Sure.
And they're available.
Thank you. Who's going next? Do we go sequentially or?
We could, please.
Thank you. State of primary healthcare in India. I think if we were to divide India's population into 5 quintiles, the first quintile would make a statement that the health facilities in India are at par with the best in the world, so no question. The second quintile would also nearly make that statement, although neither the first nor the second quintile would have any significant level of access to any form of insurance or reimbursement. But if you have money in the pocket, there are facilities of reasonable high standards available in the country. Our struggle starts with the third quintile and goes on to the fourth and the fifth quintile, where unfortunately we have a long way to go. The real challenge, if I have to make a very succinct statement, 70% of healthcare resources in India exist in the public sector. And 30% of healthcare delivery in India happens in the public sector. 30% resources in the private sector and 70% delivery. So we have an overloaded, at times substandard private sector, and we have an underloaded, but with its own challenges, the public sector. So I think there is only one way of winning the battle of primary healthcare. We have to dissolve this distinction between public sector, private sector, and the philanthropy, which is a big, big influencer of healthcare everywhere in the world, and we're really happy. So in India, initiatives like WISH. We need to all come together and agree that we need this as a common mission. It's a common problem. What you mentioned, healthcare with dignity, it's so important. It's everybody's birthright. So I think let's not pretend to be ostriches to believe that we are in a very healthy state. The bottom two quintiles and a good part of the third quintile have real challenges. And no significant disease appears from the sky. It all happens because we ignored primary health care. A simple blood test can show up if everything is right with the body or wrong. Even early stage cancer is treatable. Every early stage disease is nearly treatable. Even genetically prone disease, genetically influenced disease can be tackled if they are at an early stage, and that early stage is primary health care. So a combination of availability through the modern medicine stream, through the Ayush stream, and if possible, in any way, the informal stream, combined with the diagnostic capability, I think we will be able to say that we have made a significant improvement in primary health care capability in the country.
That's a very strong private sector statement. So can we just go to Navinji and then come back to the civil society and the others?
Mr. Chaudhary has given private sector version, so naturally everybody will expect that I will be giving a version in the favor of government sector. But let me give a very objective kind of view. As a district collector and then as a mission director, National Health Mission, what I have observed, I have been a student of management, and what I really see in the government sector is that there is no cost-benefit analysis. Whatever we are doing because we have announced. If we have announced, we will do by our typical routine method. And a PHC near Jaipur may be much more different from a PHC on the border of Pakistan.
Sure.
But the same manpower will be hired, same building will be made. There it may be unused. In Jaipur, we may need more floors, more rooms. But because our norms are very typical, we will not go for that. Secondly, I find that there is vacancy. As far as Rajasthan is concerned, people don't want to work in certain areas because they are very remote, because they are desert, tribal, hilly areas. They are difficult areas. And when I see as an administrator, I find that when a doctor has, you know, given so much years, why he will work in Barmer, where he will not get milk and vegetables in the evening? Mm-hmm. So if I get sadistic, you know, I will criticize doctors. You know, they don't want to serve India. But when I see, you know, even everybody wants a minimum standard of life for his family. So we never think about that, you know, when we are trying to send doctors to such difficult areas, are we thinking of making a comprehensive kind of township where everything is available so that these issues are solved? Have we ever tried to make available coffee and tea machines which are available at a small office? We never think about that. We always believe that our compounders and doctors will go outside at Thadiwala and they will have tea from there, because we never think like that. So what I believe that too much activities, too much programs which come from government, like yesterday Indradhanush program was launched. Same PHC people, no new staff has been given, but now you have to cover 2 lakh more children and then they have to be given immunization. You will identify them, you will go to them, you will immunize them. And your routine activities will continue because people will fall ill and they will come to you. You have to serve. If you are not there, next day media will print it, doctor was not available. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how we are going to solve it. Generally, there are vacancies. If at all people are there, there is absenteeism. Very large scale of absenteeism is found. And even people are present, there is no motivation. And even if there are some motivated people, we are not caring for their career progression. So I find these issues very much prominent when I see them from a very, very independent point of view, not from a governmental point of view. And what really puzzles me is that in our PHCs, we are already short of doctors. In Rajasthan, we have around 2,100 PHCs. So I should have at least 2,100 doctors in my PHCs. I don't have. I have 1,400 doctors for 2,100 PHCs. So some of the PHCs are, you know, run by Ayush doctors. They are good. They are running it very well. But still, you know, there is a protocol. An Ayush doctor is not expected to dispense medicines which are allopathic medicines.
Sure.
We may allow because nobody is saying it. And, you know, someday somebody will see to it and object to it. But, you know, I don't know. It can happen, it may not happen. So, there was a talk in the government of India that there will be some kind of bridge course to be given to Ayush doctors to bring them, you know, somewhere equivalent to allopathic. I don't know MCI or, you know, IMA, whether they will allow it or not. I'm not aware. But we have to have something in place so that I can fill my PhDs at the first place. If I'm not able to do that, if you see the second aspect of the same thing, our doctors who are already short, they are doing accounting, they are doing IT. They are doing promotive healthcare, preventive healthcare. All these works, IC, BCC, these all things could be done by developing a parallel public health cadre. A graduate, if he's trained for 1 month, 6 months maximum, mm-hmm. he can do all these things. But you know, we will puzzle that only doctor with all these things also. We want a UCCC from him if construction is going on from the same doctor. So I find that, you know, when you are already in shortage of doctors for your PhDs, you have to give these activities, which are non-medical kind of activities, to some people who are, and we have so many unemployed people who can be given these skills very easily. Mm-hmm. So I think these are the issues which I
That's
find.
That's very well put. Problem. I mean, so the shortage of doctors is something that we keep hearing, but then the what is available, how well we are managing them, how well we are taking care of them, will determine, you know, what we can provide despite all these shortages. And of course, I mean, this it's not just that the medical responsibilities being given to the Ayush or the senior nurses. It's also there are non-medical work which the doctors are expected to do. And it becomes really, really difficult. And particularly in states like Rajasthan, you know, where you go to those places, I mean, it's very far. There's nothing really. I mean, it's really difficult to live. Okay, so let me move to Dr. Sudarshan. How do you... You have been running some PhDs in tremendous places like, you know, Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram, and even in Rajasthan, I think you have been running one of them. So what's your experience?
The problems, yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I think let me define when we say primary healthcare, we different people mean different. I believe in comprehensive primary healthcare, the Alma-Ata declaration which said preventive, promotive, curative and rehabilitative services. And which involves mother and child health, communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, all put together in a comprehensive primary health care. So from that perspective, again, India is vast. We have rural and urban. Urban primary health care is the challenge today, and we have just opened up. We don't have urban primary health care system, and now some of the cities are doing it. Now rural areas, again, tribal, very remote, northeastern, inaccessible areas, and also very well good setup of primary health care like Kerala, where Kerala, again, the governance, decentralized governance, the gram panchayats manage the primary health centers, running fairly well. There is no question of absenteeism because the gram panchayats manage. So they are, these are varieties of spectrum you see in the country. Now the major problem seems to be not in the well-governed states, but in very backward northeast central India and many of the northern Indian states, is the human resources, which I will not repeat those things, but again, the lack of essential drugs, essential emergency drugs not available, in a vast country like this with so much effort, we are still not able to provide essential drugs. That's the challenge. HR, a lot has been talked about it. We need to really see the informal providers. I work with the informal providers in tribal areas with the tribal traditional healers. I think they are a great asset. We need to integrate them into the primary healthcare system. I'm not recommending the quacks to become part of the primary healthcare system, but traditional healers have some knowledge and how that can be understanding and becoming part of the comprehensive primary healthcare system is very important. Again, another myth about, I think the next session, next door, is about the bottom of the pyramid, that spending 80% out-of-pocket expenditure. So there's a lot of money there. How can we have profit-making business models for primary healthcare? I think this is something absurd. If they are already spending, they are impoverished, they cannot come out of poverty cycle, how can you make a business out of this money? There's plenty of money there. but that comes of the poor people's money and further exploiting. Maybe we'll provide good quality primary health care, curative service. They talk only about curative services. I don't think preventive and promotive can be profitable. So we need to do a lot of unwanted diagnostics and all of that models of business models. I think, again, I'm very, very cautious about that. It has to be publicly funded primary health care. And the private sector, which is doing a lot of disservice in the country, further exploiting the poor people. So we need to be very, very cautious when we say private sector. The quacks is another problem, but traditional healers do not charge much, so they don't exploit. So we need to look at all these dimensions of the primary healthcare system. But positive note, NRHM has made some impact in the overall primary healthcare situation in the country. The ASHAs, I've been part of the ASHA, I'm the ASHA mentoring group. I think it's a great asset we have created in the country, and there are many other positives which have happened, but we have a long way to go. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Swarup, would you like to?
Not much to add after all that's been said, but I think I would obviously endorse a lot of the views which have been said, that primary healthcare in India is still a challenge for us. Lots needs to be done, and I think that's really why we are here. But one point which I thought I would like to highlight is, I'll go with what was said, that somewhere where we divide these lines as to what is needs to be public sector driven, what needs to be private sector driven, I think that brings in slight challenges into the system. Primarily why I would say that is because I think good statistics were brought out there when you said with 70% resources, 30% delivery and vice versa. We have a lot being done in the country, which is therefore improvement of the primary healthcare services. Probably that's not being very well integrated into what is even existing today. And that is why, because first of all, we have tendencies of working in silos. We don't really do the connections. Secondly, if you look at where the public sector delivery system is, 70% of it, I think that machinery is not geared up to bringing in or absorbing the new technologies, the new skill development that's required.
Absolutely.
And I think that is where the private sector is probably today better geared up to absorb it, but they do not have that machinery through which they could execute it. So if somewhere that connection is brought in, and you take in, because there is a lot happening, and probably as we move into the panel, you know, organizations like ours, the USAID, we are investing in new technologies, new skill developments. That has to trickle down to the base. And once that comes in, is where you'll start seeing the improvements. I think that somewhere we have to now try and concentrate. And organizations like WISH, I mean, I think you're doing human service by even getting everyone here on one platform to discuss that issue. So those delivery systems are very important for us to see how we take it ahead.
Nancy, USAID has been sort of working in this area for many, many years, and you've funded, you've provided technical, you know, assistance of very high value. And so where do you see, I mean, what are the things which have worked? What are the things which we shouldn't touch or relook at?
Wow, that's a very difficult question.
So sure, please carry on.
Allow
please.
Me, I think one of the things that maybe I can contribute, the experts here who've talked about your primary healthcare system, when Alma Ata was announced, and yes, that's my generation too, I think at that point in time, it was more of a dream and a slogan to try to motivate people around health for all. So for me, the importance of talking about primary health care, about promotive and primary care, is that we now have the interventions that we know works. So as an agency, we have set ourselves a goal to end preventable child and maternal deaths. Never did I dream that in my lifetime we could set a goal like that. So we know enough from around the world now. We know enough about what can prevent maternal preventable deaths. The same thing with HIV/AIDS. We now have a goal to create an AIDS-free generation. I mean, these are really bold goals. Unlike the goals 20 years ago, where we didn't have a timeline, we've now done the statistical modeling. We are aiming to end preventable mother and child deaths by 2035 around the world. And India is a critical partner for us. So for me, the importance of addressing these issues that have been raised across your promotive and preventive and your primary care and even your secondary care is because it can work. And we know it works now. We have the evidence that there are tools that work. So maybe I can just add that from that global goals that we should be hopeful and we should be excited and committed to resolving these issues because it can save lives and improve the quality of those lives, whether it's through the public or the private.
I'll come back to you. I mean, there's a lot of know-how, there's a lot of knowledge, and how effectively that's being utilized. What's worked in HIV, what's worked in TB, what's worked in polio, how that can be sort of replicated in case of primary healthcare, despite all the challenges. It's far more complicated area. I think that's something which I would like to probe a little more a little later. Dave, you have been sort of raising money for healthcare. And so what has been the response of the market when you talk about primary healthcare versus secondary, tertiary, and all those?
I think what we're seeing is, as a venture investor, we're looking for innovations that are have breakthrough, disruptive opportunities to improve healthcare. So we're looking at things that can lower the cost, increase the accessibility, make things possible that on low even low resource environments. So as we raise money for and then look to invest money in healthcare, we tend to look very much at either innovations on technology, which are kind of obvious, you know, looking for new devices or new inventions that improve, could be applied to improve healthcare. But I think actually the thing that's most disruptive or required to be disruptive is innovations in business models. So we're seeing that as one of the big drivers because there's just too much friction in the marketplace right now for technology to even get deployed, even if it exists. There's actually a lot of technology that's not deployed and could be deployed. So we're seeing really interesting innovative business models. One of the examples that we've invested in is the diagnostic as a service model, where in this case it's an eye screening for diabetic retinopathy, telemedicine kind of model, where instead of someone having to buy a diabetic clinic having to buy a camera, specialized camera, and to hire an ophthalmologist, and you know the costs just go sky high. These guys have figured out a way to go to a diabetologist and say, most diabetologists in India, if you go to a diabetic clinic, most of them, there's no eye screening. It's too expensive to offer. And so they go in and say, rather than we'll put the camera in, we'll train your technician, and you can add, in this case it's private healthcare, this could be covered by schemes and stuff as well, but it costs 200 rupees and you pay us 100, and it's a seamless, and this is scaling very quickly into parts of India that they've never had eye screening before. So diabetics are getting screened that never got screened before. So that's an example where technology is in play, but also a business model has been brought in. And whether that's done in a public health situation or a privately funded, I think the business model is really important.
Thank you. So far, I mean, at the end of the first round, what I see is that there is this right issue that we have to keep in mind when we are talking about primary health. Ultimately, it's a dignity of the, it's a human right that we have to sort of keep in mind. We have talked about shortage, but then more importantly, I think what Navinji brought out, the lack of management, lack of care for the providers, that needs to be addressed. We have also talked about technology. I mean, Dr. Sarv started, and so we are saying that, you know, why not use technology? I mean, those innovations, technology, or the new ways of resolving these issues that need to be looked at. And of course, only private has its own sort of demerits and merits, and only public has already documented its merits and demerits. So how can we strike a balance between the two is something that which came up. So I'll pick up one by one. I mean, say technology is definitely one of the things. I mean, particularly in states like Rajasthan, where the density of population is one of the lowest, and it's the largest state. So if technology doesn't work there, where else can it work? I mean, I was just looking at some of the statistics. The state has 70 million population, and there are 52 million mobile users in that state. And out of that 52 million, 50% of them belong to rural Rajasthan. Now, this is amazing figures. I don't know what cell phones are those, what kind of connections, whether they work on, I have no idea, but these are all published statistics. Now, here is a, you know, one of the public sector gentlemen sitting here who is such a tech, you know, sort of technology lover, and I've seen him working day and night, changing many things in that state just through the use of technology. And I would like Navinji to talk about how you have been sort of using technology to resolve many of these issues.
Use of technology, it can be divided in two parts. Like when you talk about technology in healthcare, one is having more innovative equipments, because that is also technological advancement. You have better diagnostic tools, equipments, better X-ray machines, better cure for cancer, diabetes, etc. So one is that part of technology. But with I am mostly concerned with second part of technology, that is business process engineering kind of thing. We have many processes in government, and I have seen that our procedures sometimes they are not logical. They are just there because somebody has devised them and we are following them. One of the example I would like to give, like Rajasthan is front runner today in free medicine scheme. Many states, many countries have visited us in last 8 months of my tenure. I also have extra charge of managing director of Rajasthan Medical Service Corporation, which actually runs this scheme. And by that experience, I can say that why we are successful, even after 3 years of launch of the free drug scheme, where many states have, you know, left the option in between, is that use of technology. How can you think, how will you ensure 600 kind of medicine at medical colleges, around 300 plus kind of medicines at your 500 plus community health centers, 300 plus medicines at your primary health center, and 30 medicines at your sub-center. The total number comes to 17,500 institutions in Rajasthan. Now, a small chemist, if you go to a chemist shop, he may say out of your prescription that I have 4 out of 5. And I am in government, I have to provide these much medicines, and I don't know which disease will take its burden. I don't know, swine flu came to us just in February, and you know, we were not prepared for that, because Tamiflu was not one of the essential drug in my list. So I always face this change. But e-Oshadi software, which was, this is a wonderful thing, and I will just like to sum up in two lines. When we purchase something in Rajasthan, it is entered in our system. I send these medicines at my 34 warehouses in my all 34 districts. Their data is compiled. Now the information is available to everybody. All PHC CSCs know what medicines are available with me right now. And I keep on ordering for them based on their demands. EOHD software is not restricted to my supply side. Even it is available not only in my drug warehouses, it is available at the last PHC. So I can see from here, now, how many paracetamol tablets are available at particular PHC? I have also calculated consumption speed of every medicine per day. Like I know what is the average consumption of that particular tablet, capsule, syrup per day in that particular PHC, particular district, particular block. And by managing that particular consumption speed, I am in a position to give maximum medicines. And independent study was conducted recently by WHO along with PHFI. And the most surprising fact which has come up in Rajasthan, why free drug schemes have taken up, it has been taken up very well, is 97% of the prescriptions by government doctors are generic. Nobody will believe that, you know, out of 100 prescriptions, 97 prescriptions are generic. So we are purchasing generic drugs, and in 3 years we have proved to world that generic medicines are as good as branded drugs. Mm-hmm. So Rajasthan is a very good example of showing to anybody that we are doing. And let me give you one figure. I think everybody will be surprised on that figure, because I get SMS every day in the evening how many people have been given medicine in the entire Rajasthan today. So the figure is 2.5 lakh people per day. It's around 2.5 lakh people per day. We are giving it to them. Then based on our success in free medicine scheme, we gave it, we launched free diagnostic. We are doing 30 kind of tests without any cost. And now it is, we are doing 1 lakh tests per day free. So 2.5 lakh people are getting free medicines, 1 lakh people are getting free diagnostic tests in Rajasthan. But there is one aspect to that. It has increased workload on my PHC, CHC. And now I have to compromise on the quality time which has to be given to a patient when he comes to a doctor. So we are struggling with that, how to strategically purchase services from private sector in our, generally the burden is on tertiary sector. So we are trying for some health insurance model so that we can take care of these things. Second aspect is ASHAs. You talked about ASHAs. I think people sitting here, whoever know about ASHA model, you go to any state. And we are saying that ASHAs are assets. I will say ASHAs are liabilities. Two reasons. Number one, are they trained to take care of the needs? Are they really bringing pregnant women for antenatal checkup? Are they really able to bring a woman for institutional delivery, or they are coming and they are just accompanying? Has she really motivated, or just she, because she knows that she is going? So this is very crucial quality aspect. Then whenever I went to field, I saw that, you know, hundreds of ASHAs are shouting slogans against government for the simple reason, whatever incentive they get, they don't get on time. Secondly, they get it in pieces. Number three, it is very, very small amount which is given in pieces. Then there is cut or commissions by certain accountants, oblique, MOICs, etc., etc. Second, when I joined as mission director, I asked how many ASHAs we have. They said, sir, we have 46,000 ASHAs in Rajasthan. Now, I asked, can I know what they are doing? Like, how many institutional deliveries were done by ASHAs today? Or give me last month's figure. They said, sir, how is it possible? What are you talking? Can we know about every ASHA what they are doing? So, you know, what I thought from my mind, you know, we are losing both battles. Number one, they are shouting slogans against us because we are not paying them on time, we are not paying them sufficiently. Most important, we are not paying them respectfully. And second, I'm not able to get what they are doing. So there are two problems, but thankfully we saw one problem as a solution to another problem. I simply asked, if I pay them online in their bank accounts, can they give me their working, what they are doing? They said, why not? So if I would have said, I want to monitor you and please help me, they will say, oh, you want to audit us, you want to have a check on us. But I said, No. I want to pay your payments in your bank accounts directly without interference of MOIC, accountants. Will you do it? Yes, sir. We are very much ready for this. And in grab of that, you know, I achieved my second objective by launching a software of a simple program. It is called AshaSoft. And now all 46,000 ASHAs in Rajasthan fill a form at the end of the month. Let me tell you one thing. They do 23 kinds of activities. And their payments are made at different ends. So first of all, I had to re-engineer the whole process of payment, how to gather the data. Then we had to ensure that there are entry points sufficiently manned, because you have started a system, but where to go for the entry? Now, the second question is, if they will go for entry, who will pay for their TAD, etc., etc., because these are the problems in government. Sure. So we said that when they come for their monthly meeting, they will fill the form. Then we devise a claim form. Then we trained our data entry operators at all 2,500 points we have. And now I'm very happy to say that we launched it in December, and now 4 months are there. By 7th of next month, they get the entire payment in their bank accounts directly. There is no cut, there is no intervention of the intermediaries. Mm-hmm. And best part is that, the best part is that now I can take informed decisions. Now I know which 8,000 ASHAs do not do anything. Earlier I was not able to, you know, point finger to anybody. They will say, how can you say? Now I can say, ma'am, for last 4 months, aapka incentive to zero hai. How? You are not doing anything? She will do. Secondly, now I know some ASHAs, I was not aware. My 3,000 ASHAs are postgraduates. ASHAs are expected to be 8th pass. But I have postgraduate ASHAs. And if they are doing fine also, as per my parameters, why they not should be promoted as ASHA supervisor? Mm-hmm. So that there is a career progression also. So we can take informed decisions. We came to a very surprising fact that the overall incentive, 100 rupee incentive which is given in Rajasthan, only 1 rupee is for national programs. And 35 rupee is for attending meetings. this is a very surprising thing. I'm giving 35 rupees just for attending meeting. It is giving me nothing if they are not doing any other activity. Meeting is good if you are doing something in other parameters. But I found that some ashas are just taking money only for attending meetings. So now, and the best part is that ASHA supervisors are under tremendous pressure. I have 1,500 ASHA supervisors. One day I took a meeting like this and I said them, I gave a data on the slide and I asked them, you know, where posts are vacant, average ASHA incentive is more than where you are posted. So can you please tell me why I should not remove you? It had its impact. And you know, now I'm very happy to tell you, because my ASHASoft system is based on MCTS, that is maternal and child tracking system. So ASHASoft also drew a lot of entries in my MCTS system. And in Rajasthan, you will be surprised to know, we have almost 70% data tracking. I know in which village, which woman has got pregnant, and now whether three ANCs with fourth one is optional for ASHAs, it has been done or not, institutional delivery, and after that, immunization, I can track now. So I believe that in long term, what will happen that, you know, when ASHA gets an SMS, 18,000 rupee, you will be surprised to know, they are getting 18,000, 24,000 per month now because of this system. Can you believe an ASHA can get 18,000 to 24,000? Now, when ASHA gets a message, 18,000 has been deposited in your bank account, ASHA in her neighborhood asks, kitna aaya? 18,000. Mera to 1,800 aaya. Now, that type of competition, you know, it will fuel lot of things which we were not able to do earlier. So technology has played a role. Nothing has played a role. Technology has played a role. It would have taken years of surveys to find out which ASHA is working, which ASHA
is working. And you wouldn't have got the correct picture also.
Yeah, now we are getting informed decision. And earlier we were demanding money from Government of India. We want to train 46,000 ASHAs. Please give me this much money. Now we are not asking like this. We are saying out of 46,000, we believe 16,000 ASHAs are not doing well in maternal health. We will train them for maternal health. 10,000 are not doing well for immunization. We will train them for immunization. So now we are seeking money in a justified manner, not just giving up gross figure and asking for the money. So all these things will finally lead to one day, maybe after 1 year or 2 years, that, you know, ASHA will wait for a woman to get pregnant and, you know, take her for agency. And as soon as a birth takes place, she will take that child for immunization. This is what we want. So thank you very much.
That's brilliant. So. This is what I was telling you. So I get a call at 9:30 in the night, like, you know, and later I got to know that, you know, he works on the ASHA soft after 9 o'clock in the evening. So that is the time he sort of gets the data and starts sharing with me as well. No, brilliant. This is a classical use of technology for the process, you know, and re-engineering the process. And that has really, really worked pretty well. And in fact, Rajasthan has been one of the states, and I know today, we have the pleasure of having Mr. Rawat, who's the state demographer. It's the state which started the PCTS, you know, long back. I mean, it was not known as PCTS those days. It was on an Excel sheet. They used to track it, you know, and which later on was taken over nationally and extended and scaled up, you can say. And today it is known as PCTS. So their HMIS is also very, very robust and very, very insightful. There are a lot of scope for improvement, I'm sure, but, like, you know, this is one of the states where you can get data. And unless you have the evidence, it's very difficult to get, you know, proper decisions made by the government people. Technology. So, Dr. Saurabh, you were talking about technology and he's given you a classic example. I know this doesn't cover the device, but devices can definitely be added to ensure more of early diagnostics, doorstep diagnostics, low-cost diagnostics, etc., etc. Let me now come to that slightly more complicated area, which is what we are saying, how to strike the balance between this private and the public and the civil society. Because it is very clear that everybody cannot afford to pay and everybody cannot, by constitutional right, cannot be charged because they do not have the capacity. So there has to be a proper segmentation, and that cannot be one time. It has to be an ongoing process. So how do we sort of, you know, work that out? So those who have the capacity to pay, they shouldn't be misutilizing the scarce resources, whereas those who are not in a position, let them utilize the free services. So how do we go about building this a robust sort of PPP for a primary healthcare, system? Who would like to start? Pavith, you have a lot of thoughts on this, I'm sure.
Thanks.
On a lighter note, I think there is already a public-private partnership in Rajasthan. So the doctors are allowed to practice at home, and in many times it's at the daytime. So there's a salary paid by the public, but the practice is at home. So, but that was on a lighter note. It doesn't happen everywhere. But the point I was making is that there is a privatization of public services in any case in many parts of the country, including in Rajasthan, and also happens in primary healthcare space. But that's a bit of a perverted way of the partnership. And if that can be, if there are ways to make it constructive. I feel over the last 2-3 years since I've kind of gone back to the field and looked at it more closely in the area that we are working in, we found excellent examples of working together with private as well as public players, ours being a more of not-for-profit kind of a setup. But there have been excellent partnerships with private hospitals, especially for referral care services, and with public for several entitlements that are due for the patient. So a not-for-profit operating in a remote, rural, hard-to-reach areas, using the entitlements that the government or the public sector has for the families, and a private sector that has a very well-stocked, well-staffed referral hospital, kind of tying that in together. So the problem, I think, as somebody said, that in India the primary healthcare is fragmented, and the challenge is how do you connect those different dots together to make it happen. There is a power in private sector, but it doesn't reach out to the poorest 2 quintiles or 3 quintiles, as my colleague said earlier. There is a power in public sector. There are huge network of public facilities, even the 2100 PHCs that Mr. Jain referred to.
2285 to be precise.
2285 now. But 1400 physicians at the moment, and that leaves the space for how do you innovate? How do you innovate in the public space? Okay. And I think one of the problems with the public space is the limitations for innovation, unless there is somebody really dynamic and takes on certain things. And that's where I think a public and a private mix could really, really be helpful with the civil society coming in. And as I said, that there are huge possibilities of tapping the, especially I would again go back to say that it is very, very unlikely that a comprehensive primary healthcare services space, especially in remote areas, a private player will operate, because there is very little paying capacity, there is very little, but there is a huge, I think it's also coming back to the question of what is primary healthcare. Primary healthcare has the responsibility of ensuring care, coordinating care at other levels as well. It's not sufficient to say that I treat these 4 diseases and for 50 go wherever. So if you have to coordinate that, you need other players in the ecosystem to work with, and wherever there are those energies and resources, in a setting which is otherwise low resource, so whatever resources are available do need to be tapped. And there is no, I don't see any contradiction in that.
Absolutely, and this has been documented. It's there in the National Health Mission and also the plan, the 5-year plan. Yet, when it actually comes to implementation of it, somehow it's getting stuck somewhere. So where is the bottleneck? What's the problem? Please.
This might be a good opportunity to invite our chief economist in it to talk about one of the things we're interested in is the role of health financing as both a tool to bring different types of providers as well as a tool to stimulate a certain quality or standard of care. So Nanda, I don't know if you'd like to just say a few things about the role of health financing.
Could somebody just give him a microphone? It's up here.
Yeah, I can use that. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't come prepared for this. But I think at a very fundamental level, let's look at this. Economic growth, which is taking place in India and elsewhere, creates a unique opportunity, right, of thinking of how we can leverage economic growth to actually address a market failure. Everything we've talked about here is a failure of markets to function well. If the markets were functioning well, then we would not be having a discussion of why does primary healthcare not meet what it's supposed to do. If you want to do that, my feeling is that creating a segmenting markets by creating a market for the poor and one for the non-poor is probably not the way to go. Right? You invariably you end up with a poorly financed, poorly provided care for the poor and a probably well-financed, well-provided market for the non-poor.
you have to bring the poor into the market, into the service delivery model that the non-poor are using. So we should look differently about who pays for it and who delivers it. I mean, I think we somehow seem to combine the two. So we should get, and in a situation like India, where there's a large private market, being agnostic to ownership and being smart about buying is probably going to lead better results than this philosophical divide between, there seems to be this clash between, you know, the public sector is good, the private sector is bad, for a variety of reasons. And the private sector says, we are good and you are bad, for a variety of reasons. This lack of mistrust has to be done away with. And money is powerful. Okay. So money, okay, and financing is powerful. If you look at the more developed economies, insurance and financing have shaped markets. Right? If you look at where investment in R&D takes place, why are people investing in R&D? Because there is a hope that somebody is going to pay for the product at some point. In the absence of an assurance, nobody will invest in technology. So in India, the real challenge, in my view, is how can one leverage and organize financing to use its power to incent markets to organize themselves so they are more responsive to the needs of the poor. So that's, I mean, in a sense, I think there's a huge power there which we have markets that we can leverage.
Any other thoughts on the same subject? Do you want to? Yep.
Rajasthan has announced its budget last month. If you see our budget announcements in health sector, 40% announcements are only for PPP. So Rajasthan, in a very big way, has opened its gates for various PPP options, starting contracting out complete PHCs to private partners. Like, we will give our PHC completely to you if you can run it. We will give you the budget which we were supposed to incur if we would have run it. And we are asking for you through a RFP soon. And RFP has been drafted. It is in the final, we are expecting finance to actually agree to it. But still, I will say one thing. I may look anti-government again, but what I see, because I have been a management student and that comes between my government working, lack of flexibility. Whenever, you know, we start making RFP, I have been a member of various RFP making processes. And when all our finance people, various, you know, experts sit there, and when I say, you know, let's make RFP for contracting out a PHC to a private partner, they will say, sir, okay, we will pay this much. Then they will say, conditions kya honge? What will be the conditions imposed? Sir, 100 ka OPD hona chahiye har roj. The population of the village is 450. How to make 100 people fall ill every day? So, you know, I will say, yaar, 50 kar lete hain. No, sir, it doesn't justify, because in that district we have done 100, how can we do 50 here? So I don't understand, when demographic profile is different, how can you do this? So such a district opinions, actually, you know, we start floating things, but soon we become sadistic, and finally when draft comes out, private sector says, you are again there. So I believe this time our people would have done better, because I was not part of PPP RFP this time. So I hope that it is good and quite inviting for the people who want to work in Rajasthan. I think this flexible thinking is somewhere absent in our RFPs. We get statistic about targets, and which are generally unrealistic. So that, if can be taken care of, PPPs can work.
Okay. Dr. Sudarshan, do you have any view on this?
I think. Working with the government public-private partnership is a very important. I have been doing this for the last 20 years, and now we started in Karnataka. We work in Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Orissa, and now in Rajasthan also will be starting soon. Basically, the concept is in primary healthcare, it has to be publicly funded. I mean, squeezing money, doing private user fee, even including World Bank studies have shown that user fee in a primary healthcare setup, it is a disastrous. It will not work. So we need to be. We also work with the CSR with the companies, and we run several primary healthcare projects with the CSR also. These are the two: either government and CSR. Government has been very often we, the both the civil society and the private sector, we shy away saying everything government is corrupt. I was also in Lokayukta, I know I can talk much more about corruption and lack of accountability. I was the chairman of the task force in Karnataka, we found non-operating ophthalmic surgeons, non-operating obstetricians, non-operating, and they were paid the same salary. There was no performance appraisal. Now we are after ASHAs for their performance appraisal. I appreciate that tool, but we should use the same tool for all the big people in the system, and they should be made accountable also. So there are a lot of unaccountability in the system, and we need to have good management. And this is what we bring in when they identify the most difficult primary health centers which they cannot manage, and they are usually identified by the DHOs, CMHOs. And when we give the infrastructure what they have, and we give the choice to the human resources to continue with us on deputation, or we recruit the new staff. And with those parameters and some, the negotiation for financing government in Karnataka, they said we'll give you 75% of what we are spending. This was the beginning of the PPP in the country, so I had to compromise and say accept that. Later on it became 90% in most of the states. And nobody, I think now some few states are saying we'll give 100%, which doesn't include management costs and training costs. So we were at the receiving end, and this budget is about 160 rupees per, not the capital cost, the recurring cost for primary health care in India on an average in the country is about 160 rupees per person per year. We have to manage mother and child health, communicable and non-communicable diseases, everything in that included. So with those limitations we did, we had a lot of problems, red tapeism, corruption. One of the ministers in one of the state, he said he wanted 10% kickbacks for the partnership. We had such difficult situations. But now we established the brand, Karuna Trust brand. We don't give any bribes, and still we get those contracts and we continue to do it. Sometimes the reimbursement doesn't come up for a year, but there are many positive things. I think in the beginning this partnership, the lack of faith and trust in both the partners, I think we need to build that partnership and take it forward. And I am happy to say now we cover 1 million population. And last year I just calculated, if these PHCs were not managed by Karuna Trust, you know, 550 infants would have died. That's based on their infant mortality. So we have prevented 550 infant deaths in the project area which we are doing. So with a little less than what government is spending, we are able to do much better health outcomes in these primary health centers. So that's the model. We also made some innovations in management. There is no administrator in a primary health center. So there's a post called first division clerk or second division clerk, and he's paid a good sum of money. And he has only 2 days job to do some accounting and all that. So we have converted that post into an administrator. So good management of is very important. Zero tolerance for corruption. And the HR, we have very huge problem in the Northeast. So using the Ayush doctors, EMOC trained, we also run FRU. So we have EMOC trained, 4 months trained, MEBS, lady doctors doing C-sections. We have made some of these HR innovations also. IT has been a strength for us. We take up IT only after the health system is in place. The HR, the infrastructure is in place, because without good infrastructure and the health system in place, IT will not be much used. Now we have a drug, a Logistimo, we work with Logistimo. All our primary health centers, we know the stockouts. Vaccines, now we have 99% availability of vaccines and emergency drugs in the primary health centers. That's possible because of the simple cell phone technology with the Logistimo, and we are now trying drones in Arunachal Pradesh to supply emergency vaccines and drugs for the, these are very hilly areas, so this can be really life-saving drones which can take the essential emergency drugs to the very remote areas. Telemedicine, we work with ECO, and it has tremendous potential. We are also working with D3 and EMC Square on developing tools for auxiliary nurse midwives for the health workers. We have these tablets, and the A&M is empowered. Instead of carrying those 23 registers, she has only a tablet, and she knows when she goes to the village, she knows how many to be immunized, how many ANC cases to be checked up, all the details. And if he misses an immunization dose, it pops up in our in the tablet that you have not missed this dose. you have missed this, dots, dose has been missed. All these are tremendous possibilities. So I feel IT has tremendous, but IT is not a solution for bad healthcare system, bad primary healthcare system. That I want to emphasize, put the primary healthcare system, add all the IT into it, it will wonderfully work. I'm also into health insurance. I think again, I'm in Karnataka, we have the Yashaswini, the RSPY, and the Suvarna Suraksha Trust, which does the, for the tertiary care. Now the private sector financing, I entirely agree for tertiary care, which we are doing. I'm the chairman for the empanelment of private hospitals. We empaneled about 160 hospitals. About 550 procedures are done free of cost for all BPL card holders now, including Narayan Hrudayalaya the Ali and all of that. So that type of partnering with the for-private with good accreditation, and we also have the payments made to the private hospitals for these procedures. If they have any NABH accreditation, we pay them more. So incentives for good quality services also. There's tremendous possibilities in bringing that. RSPY is something, it appears that now they're going to move it from the finance department to from the labor department to the health department. In Karnataka, we have labor department doing RSPY, health department doing Vajpayee Aarogyashri, now it's called Rajiv Aarogyashri, and the third one is the cooperative department doing Yashaswini, trying to bring all the three departments together and make it into a comprehensive universal health coverage where both BPL and APL also have health insurance mechanism for the secondary and the tertiary care. So I feel that it's tremendous positive PPP. I'm happy Rajasthan is also opening. We will also be working with the Wish Foundation. And I think the challenge is to see that it works in, I've not succeeded in getting into UP and Bihar yet, but these are my dream places. Rajasthan, I had applied 3 years back. Same, as you rightly said, the RFPs and all of that never worked. So hopefully we have the partnership with Rajasthan government too. Thank you.
Better late than never, so don't worry. One of the things which I think is very clear that we are not talking about segmentation in the context of like, you know, somebody is getting a bad quality, somebody is getting good quality. It's segmentation to decide who is going to pay for that cost. I think that has to be very clearly defined. The second thing which comes out very clearly is that telemedicine, IT, they need human touch. So we can't disconnect the systems and technology from the human and expect it to sort of deliver. I mean, first time when I went to Rajasthan and started talking about telemedicine, after about a couple of meetings, I stopped talking about telemedicine because every time I uttered the word telemedicine, everybody said, telemedicine doesn't work. If you want to come and do telemedicine here, please don't come here. And then we had to really spend our time to understand what went wrong. And what we found out was the human element was missing there. And that was, I mean, okay, at ISRO and all, like, you know, bandwidth, all those issues were there. But those are short-term issues. You can always tackle those. But really, there was no dedicated team. There was no dedicated doctor. When the patients were there, doctors were not there. When the doctors were there, patients were not there. And that was the critical reason there. So telemedicine, yes, EMC score, we have seen, you know, the data analytics is a very critical thing, how we can sort of bring out those evidences so that people can take decision at different levels. I think we have covered a lot, and I'm really happy to see that there is a working model which we are talking about in terms of PPP. I know there is a lot of work that needs to go in because civil society has to have a different model as compared to a private sector when they're coming in, and if they're putting in money, then obviously there has to be a risk transfer that needs to be detailed out in a much more professional way rather than just a contracting out kind of a mechanism. And this in this context, I would just like to leave one point behind to ponder on before I just ask you to summarize and come out with these 2-3 points, is that there is a difference between partnership and a contracting supplier. And this is a very critical difference. I mean, you're dealing with professionals, and if government doesn't understand that, you know, they are not suppliers. Karuna Trust cannot be a supplier, Basic Healthcare cannot be a supplier, SRL cannot be a supplier. They're partner. There has to be an equal partnership there. That respect, that dignity, that sharing of the resources, sharing of the thought, sharing of the strategies. And that's the only way PPP can work. Mistrust, distrust, whatever you say, it comes because that basic understanding has never been discussed out in the open, and that needs to be done. So with that, I think the last point which still remains, and Nancy, I keep coming back to you, knowledge. USAID has got so much of stuff, knowledge, you know, best practices, center of excellence, archives, and it's full of knowledge. How do we get hold of that knowledge? How do we put that into practice? There is so much of knowledge. CIFSA, my goodness, 20 years of knowledge. So how do we utilize all those? Can we have access to that knowledge bank?
Of course.
Yeah?
Of course.
Sure. So I would think, like, you know, if we can sort of initiate some kind of a knowledge hub initiative where, you know, all these best practices or the lessons learned, sometimes, you know, the mistakes actually give you better learning than the successes. So if we can sort of get access from, we have been talking to Gates Foundation as well, that they have been sort of running the program in Bihar, very similar situations, very similar problems. So why can't we sort of have those lessons and then we can share with other states? We just started doing a public sector innovations mapping. And you won't believe we got about 300 odd innovations from the public sector. Now there is no innovator attached to that. So there is no scale up, there is no business model. These are very simple. In public sector, nobody talks about innovation the way Navin Jayanji talks about. There it is a problem versus solution. So there was one problem we came across, there's somebody who was describing innovation. This guy was supposed to be in charge of supervising the beds of a 1,000-bed hospital. And he was supposed to check whether the bed sheets have been changed. And he couldn't do it, and so therefore he stopped doing it. And so there were a lot of complaints and things like that. And then later on it was found that, you know, that he said, like, you know, all the bed sheets are white, so how do I know which one has been changed and which has not been changed? So there was some supervisor who came up with an idea that, you know, okay, fine, why don't you use like 7 different colors for 7 different days? So then obviously your job becomes easier. So his job really became easier. He started doing work in a very efficient manner, but the cost went up a little bit. And so therefore, a solution which was agreed upon was that white bed sheet remains white, but with a border which is differently colored for different days. The price was again under the control and the problem was solved. Now, this will never go down in the history as innovation, but there are several plethora of such kind of ideas and solutions from the public sector that we are gathering. And we would like to place this in our website and, like, you know, seek solutions from the private sector. Can you convert these into some kind of business models? Mm-hmm. And it is not just the bed sheet kind of an example, but, you know, there are several things, like, you know, even DAP, for example, you know, district committee, you know, planning, how to encourage the bottom up planning and so on and so forth. So with that, I will may I request the entire panel to, like, just think through and come up with those 2-3 key points. Because Sunil feels that, you know, you are much better prepared to do that than Sunil himself. He does exactly the same thing with me, don't worry. So, who wants to start?
Okay, I'll go first.
Yep, please.
You want to go first?
No, I thought we were starting from there, so that's fine.
No, please, you can start.
Thank you. I think wonderful discussion. We've settled on one thing, that in healthcare, there's nothing called free. Mm-hmm. Somebody's paying for it. And what Nandakumar brought out beautifully, and Dave also reiterated the same point, that there's two issues, really. We have paucity of resources, sure, but are we optimally using the resources that we have? The answer, unfortunately, is no. There is capacity and capability. Is that capacity and capability being optimally used to meet the national health goals? The answer is no. And therefore, we need to be very clear that there is a taxpayer behind every free scheme, and it is a fundamental right of the taxpayer to know that whatever is happening correctly. And Soumitra, thank you for bringing out that this is not contracting, this is not supplier-vendor relationship, this is partnership. And partnership happens between equals. Because at the other end is human life, which we cannot play in terms of numbers. every human's right to receive basic health care cannot be questioned. The one point that I'd like to emphasize, that we have the state, we have the private sector, and we have the civil society or philanthropy. And at least two successful examples of bringing together exist. One has been in the domain of tuberculosis. The other has been in terms of some of the states coming forward and asking private sector to help them run their diagnostic services. In the first case, in tuberculosis, and that's the point, Mr. Vadwani, you also made, that we do have successful examples of specific disease. But there are learnings that could be used for the larger public health, primary health domain. Now, what happened in case of tuberculosis, just for benefit of all? The National Tuberculosis Mission has a program that if you're diagnosed for TB, you get free medication. And despite that, at least 500,000 people, if not more, were not diagnosed. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the disease degenerated into multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis and became a major challenge. Now, the public sector and private sector came together with the intervention of the philanthropic sector. We brought in Gates Foundation, we brought in Clinton Foundation, we brought in the Global Fund, and many others together to become the neutral umpire in this whole situation. The initiative was mentored, monitored by the philanthropic sector, which is not for profit. Mm-hmm. And therefore, to the point that Dr. Nandakumar so beautifully made, there is a trust deficit. And how do you get the trust deficit? You need to bring one person and the other person together and get them to shake their hands. So I think what WISH is doing and what WISH-like institutions are doing is what India needs. Bringing public sector and private sector together to solve a common problem. The problem is the same. And what we saw very recently at the time of outbreak of swine flu in different parts of the country, WISH Foundation approached us, Rajasthan is a problem. We quadrupled our capacity overnight. We came forward. We said, forget about what's the price of doing the test. Let us just do it. And at a certain volume, even low price becomes interesting because there is volume. And if there is one thing that is not in paucity in India, that is volume. We have people and people and people.
And diseases.
And disease. So I think if we take the message from this gathering today of doing our bit to bridge the trust deficit, if we are state, if we are cooperative, if we are a trust, let's all come together. And let's find a mechanism of helping those that need help.
Thank you. Yeah, please.
I think one point that's come out very clearly and is, if of course, we have to compliment states which are now coming forward and being innovative and looking at new technologies and looking at trying to take this through the public-private partnership models. Wherever you're talking, and it came out when Mr. Jain was talking about what he did in Rajasthan of trying to scale up and trying to take numbers into it, he suddenly said that we didn't have sufficient people to do that because obviously the burden on the people was more. So what do we do? How do we try and make it more efficient, the system that is there? The affordability, accessibility, the quality issues are obviously there. And I think that's really where we are talking about new interventions in terms of new diagnostics, new devices, new other technologies, not only the IT technology. The IT technology as a database for gathering information and data on what your disease burden is, on what your population is important, but the IT technology plays a very major role in actually being able to take these diagnostics devices to you, etc. Now that has to be, as I said right in the beginning also, you have to deploy these, and these PPP models have to come forward to take them on. If you talk about anything that's going to be scaled up, the basic principles of any scale up, the basic challenges in scale up, it's same. It means any sort of a process optimization that you need to do. So you cannot go with what is conventionally being used. You need to look at newer technologies. What currently is happening is we have a large number of organizations now who are investing in new technology development. of course, I represent one of those, but then you have USAID, you have the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation for the international, and within the government system, you have the ICMR coming forward, you have DST, DBT, CSIR, you have many of the other sectors coming forward. So you do have technologies now which are sitting there. There are two issues that and challenges that we are facing when we are looking at these technology developments. We have a large number of products, new devices, diagnostics, which are ready to be there into the market. Those young entrepreneurs who are coming to us have possibly the solutions for the problems that you have. Now, they really don't know how to access those markets.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know how to reach those markets, because for them, a market is a very typical business model of going to a market, taking it to a manufacturer and putting it through a sale and taking it there. So they don't know how to reach these markets. The other challenge that we're having is that while you have the problems, these problems are not being conveyed to them. So the prototypes that are being developed or the new technologies which are being looked at and supported are not need-based.
Mm-hmm.
So I think connecting that, and we are trying to do it now. If you look at some of the major programs that we've supported, the Stanford India Biodesign Program, what BIRAC is doing through SPURSH, we are doing these need identification, we're doing field immersion, we're giving these entrepreneurs field immersion. They work with clinicians, they work with hospitals and say, what is your problem? Let me work towards identifying a solution for you. So I think if you try and connect them early on, what happens is they get, so there would be a lot of problems which would be existing.
Sure.
You spoke of a simple one about a bed sheet, but if you go to the doctors, they would have so
That's
many
it.
Problems
yeah.
which would help them maybe to improve the quality of the healthcare, but also to improve the efficiencies in which they would deliver. So some would really not be very high level of innovation. They would be very simple innovations, which are just making you do something at a scale which you would not be able to do. So I think that connect is something which we have to bring in. I am also aware that we have been talking to you to try and see how through organizations like Wish, we could connect our entrepreneurs to those markets
mm-hmm.
which are existing in the public. Because for them, a public health system means it's something that's driven by the government. So their new product or technology, they have no way of reaching
mm-hmm.
that. Because it's a very complex market for them, and they do not even venture going towards that. So if we could bring in some sort of a mechanism, some sort of a platform in which we could expose these entrepreneurs, expose these new technologies to state governments who are proactive to adopt these, I think that would really make a difference. We could then try and take it to the next stage and see what we could do. And also vice versa, if we could connect them so that there could be a need identification done, and we could then throw out challenges and say, this is a need identification. Would somebody want to come and actually give a solution for this? We would be very happy to invest in this sort of a need-based solution technology development. So I think that connection is something which
That's
is
That's a
very
fantastic
important.
Suggestion. It's very critical. Because every time I go and suggest or share any kind of innovation, it draws a complete blank many times with the government departments, you know. So the exchange of, you know, innovations and ideas, that it's very critical. Any other thoughts from the panel? Yes, please, sir.
I just had a few. There's some really good ideas, but I had a few very specific. You asked for specific ideas. How about creating a public rating system and health outcome score for hospitals, clinics, doctors to drive accountability? This is something they're doing in the UK now, and I think there's huge possibilities of creating more accountability by creating a system that creates here in India. You know, it's interesting. Every doctor, probably most every health worker, has a mobile phone and knows how to use it. That's an under-leveraged, so they're already literate in how to use mobile phones. How could we leverage that? You know, I think there's an opportunity to for the MIS kind of communication systems that are used in healthcare, like India pretty much leapfrogged and went, they didn't do fixed line and went, you know, jumped quickly to mobile. I think there's an opportunity to move to digital, mobile handsets, mobile tablets in India and skip going through the traditional MIS systems that the developing world has done. There's huge opportunities to do that. And the last one is just a re-emphasis, a fast-track process for proving adoption of new technologies, specifically low-cost innovations. So is there a process where there can be a fast-track for this so that things can be approved more quickly rather than take the typical long cycles that need to happen right now.
In fact, just to add to your last point, NHSRC and along with WHO, they've introduced this whole health technology assessment certification. So what happens is, if you're developing a technology-based device or anything, any kind of application, you can actually place it to NHSRC, and they will sort of do the assessment through the WHO certified, assessors, and they will give you the certification. And that allows you to be listed in the DGSND contract. So that's a huge step forward. We should be using that. Yes, sir.
Generally, what I have seen that in government sector, like suppose MD NHM in a particular state, he has some IT background or he has some management background. He may, give more emphasis on technology or business process reengineering or simplification of procedures. Then with change of MD, the whole scenario can change.
True.
The person, what you will see in India, 10 years ago, e-governance initiative which was started, you will not see them now. Many of them you will not see now. Have any book which was released on e-governance initiative 10 years ago, you will find many of them absent now, because the person who started it is not at that position. Mm-hmm. So we are not able to institutionalize very good experiments. They have been personality based. So we have to take care of that, number one.
Absolutely.
Number two, what I want to say, in government sector, there are very, very, very good things. But, this is a very debatable thing, tenures, somebody may get a 10-month tenure, somebody may get a 3 years tenure. 10-month tenure may be fruitful, 3-year tenure may do nothing, they are not evaluated. And this 5-year plan approach in India, this has puzzled us so much. First we said that ANC honi chahiye. Look, okay, do ANC. So we emphasize ANC, ANC. 90% ANCs have started. Now, do it in first trimester. First trimester. Now again 3 year, do it in first trimester. Now 60% of first trimester. Third, ANC ho rahi hai, first trimester mein hai, but quality of ANC. HRP, high risk pregnancy, we should emphasize. Okay, now our target is HRP, identifying HRP. We are very good in identifying HRP. We claim that we have a separate card for HRP women, but now, you have identified, what about management? You have identified, very good. You say, sir, I know which 10,000 pregnant women have high risk pregnancy chances. But have you managed it? Have you ensured that they will go to the best institution possible, mm-hmm. or they will go to the same sub-center for delivery? So, we identify, then we start managing. Like we make a dam and then we start making canals. Mm-hmm. We are not making both things simultaneously, like making dam and then, having canals. But someday we find that dam is there, canal is there, but there are no farmers. So, sometimes it happens. So we have to see to it. And as far as public-private partnership is concerned, we have to be very cautious about private sector. Now let me have something on this also. I give 2-3 examples without naming anybody. I am MD of Rajasthan Medical Service Corporation. Let me tell you about one particular medicine which everybody of us uses, Cetirizine. One company gives me its generic version for 10 tablets for rupees 2. I get 10 tablets for rupees 2. And same company makes branded for 42 rupees for 10. So there is a difference of 21 times. Again, the same company has another brand name which it sells for 19 rupees for 10. I don't understand what is the difference, because as far as salt is concerned, it is same, because it is not a combo. So it's same salt. I don't understand how the procedure is different, or they put something else to make it cheap, I don't understand. Now, it is also private sector, because pharmaceutical industry is also private sector. So it has to bring out solutions. So various people are dying because they are not able to buy medicines. They can't wait for their state governments to start free drug scheme. So here, private pharmaceutical industry has a responsibility to do. Second, when health insurance scheme was started in some of the states, it was in newspapers that you trace of the whole village was removed, the ladies was removed, because for this process money was good. So then third, we see we are having a private company to run my ambulances. Okay, I will not name, but one of the company which was running it, what it did, because it had to do 5 trips to get the whole payment, So it started showing that, you know, every pickup it was doing in a small city, every trip was 30 kilometers. It is not possible at all in a small city that, you know, you are going to get a patient on the road and coming back to the hospital 30 kilometers, because it's a great criteria. When we finally audited, we found that calls were from them only. There were no patients there. So when we use private sector, we have to be very cautious about this, because I'm not saying that everybody is like this, but there are people like this.
Sure.
So,
absolutely, sir. But the thing is, PPP doesn't mean that, you know, government will not do anything. Government has to put that control. Otherwise, PPP can go very, very wrong. So, absolutely.
Again, reemphasize the word contract as a different connotation in India. It's a very bad connotation. A contract means also percentages. So I'm very happy you stress. I always say that. So don't use the, it's partnership is a more dignified word, and it's not contracts. That's why we say memorandum of understanding rather than a contract being signed. Better to use these terminologies, very important. Second, the word privatization, we still have a long, strong left-oriented people in the country. And as soon as you say PPP, it's also privatization. So we have to make it very clear, it's not privatization. Publicly funded, especially for the poor, publicly funded public-private partnership. I think that has to be qualified, otherwise all our leftist people will come and catch our neck. And quality is very important, and I think Quality Council of India is very good. I challenge them, if you can do hospital accreditation, why not primary healthcare? And they have come down. Now they have standards, NABH accreditation we have got for PHCs, and they are scaling it up. They have the machinery. So I think quality standards also need to be good quality, comprehensive primary healthcare with public-private partnership is the model which we should be looking for.
Thank you. Can I open this to the audience? I mean, you've got everything. My panelists have told you everything. Now, what do you have to say? Questions, observations, clarifications? Yes, please, start.
Back. So, I am Rajiv Kumar, coming from One Incubation Connect the Core Foundation. And we are trying something which we are discussing here in two very remote blocks of Bihar. So, problems are like that, and nothing is debatable. And in that context, like the thing, where is the solution? Like when we talk about the solution, and we have been talking that there is a population burden, there is a disease burden, there is a resource burden, but this all burden is going to the people. And then we are saying that whether we should do business out of it or we should not. But the reality is that business is happening, and this is unregulated, and this is hazardous. And people are paying out of their nose for even the small digit. So here I think the problem in our country is that the era where we are living, we are trying to do everything traditional, and anything which is innovational ultimately turns to the traditional. So that is the problem, because now if we see, probably this is a hypothesis that a scale, a speed, and sustainability, these three things are important. We can't wait for these things to happen, which will happen at over 10 or 20 years, we don't know. If we talk about the frontline workers, number of frontline workers, doctors, supply side, and all those things, but there is always a demand side, and we are ignoring that. So here, there are some strength, like people are getting services. Of course, we can debate that this is qualified or unqualified, but there is a possibility that there is a business, and that is happening, and how this money which people already is spending, and maybe more than that, and we are talking that if primary health is not qualified, then it's going to be tertiary health ultimately. So keeping that, if that segment, why we are thinking about only first quintile, second quintile, that is the problem. We should think for fifth and fourth quintile, and all quintile will get the health facility. There is the solution. So, and that will not happen that government can't do it, because our magnitude is so high and government is using public money and it has lots of limitations also, because it has to go something untraditional, something very extraordinary, and which might be very questionable, because now we have questioned everything, but we have not got the solutions. So we should try those things also, which we have always questioned.
Yeah, so the panel, just to
so
touch
I
up
want to say here that yeah. What is the feeling about that if suppose RMPs are regulated?
I'm just going to answer that. Yeah. So panel discussed that. Probably, did you come a little late? So the thing is like, yeah, informal providers who are catering to the needs of the population there, there needs to be an inclusive strategy there. However, the roles and responsibilities need to be well defined. I mean, they cannot be sort of overnight, dispensing medicines and things like that. That is not right. So we have to do that, but we have to do it strategically and carefully. So that is something which has come up. I will come to this gentleman and then you, please. Yeah. If you can use the microphone, everybody can hear that.
Hello. Hi, my name is Mihir. I went to the US 18 years ago to receive higher education, and I've been working on an innovative technology to detect breast cancer at an early stage for the last 3 years. And it gives me great pleasure to have come back to India with this innovation, where we've gotten support from the Wish Foundation. We are participating in the Start Health program of the United Seed Fund, and hopefully we get considered. And we've met with the Rajasthan Health Ministry's Office of NHM, which is working in collaboration with Wish Foundation, to Ma'am's point, to evaluate the technology through this HTA process, so that if it shows the efficacy that the, you know, from a feasibility standpoint as well as from a clinical performance standpoint, that it can be scaled up. And this is a technology that can provide an extremely low-cost solution to a pandemic that's rising, because the incidence rates have been going higher and higher, and we do not have the mechanism to replicate the Western protocols of screening in this country. So I think that, at least as an entrepreneur of a medical device technology startup, I am very enthusiastic about the mechanisms that are taking shape in India.
Thank you.
Just a comment.
Thank you very much. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Sumit. So I'm a Spurge Fellow funded by BIRAC. So I just wanted to like ask a question summing up what Mr. David and Sir said, that like there are ratings being done for ASHA workers in terms that whatever they have done, it's been like they write it in the end of 30 days and then you get to know. And he also pointed out that in UK it's been done for, like, there are public rating systems for the healthcare workers or healthcare facilities. But can this system be implemented in a place like India, where the population would be like dramatically more than what there is in UK? Or what can be the solutions to like rate these public healthcare systems in India so as to increase the efficacy of these systems?
I mean, Avinji, Dave, do you want to take the question? My take on the question is, if it can be done in the schools and colleges, the scorecards are available, why can't it be done in the public health facilities? I mean, largest of the largest, the sales forces, they have scorecards. So you see your rating every month, and you feel terrible when you see like you're like, you know, on the 10th place or the bottom of the, you know, table. So it's something which really helps.
Only problem is the rating agency can be easily bribed in India. That's the,
that's the whole point. That's
we need
why
professors.
It's
do you want to? Okay. Yeah, it can be done. I think the answer is that. Yeah, please. Last question, please. Yes.
Hello. Myself, Aditya. I'm from Kanpur, sir. And I'm working in a hospital. And I would like to talk, like, sir, the strengthening of primary healthcare you told. So is it, like, as per the discussions being going on, sir, was that through strengthening can be done only with the help of government sector and through a PPP model, which we are doing. And as Sir Naveen Sir told, in Rajasthan, we have been doing it. Sir, like you might have been a group discussion, so you might be having some various discussions with all the states coming all together, and you'll be discussing like in UP mein aisa ho raha hai, Gujarat mein aisa hai, Rajasthan mein aisa hai. So why not we cannot follow those models into UP and you being acting as a prototype?
It is happening. There are various platforms like this platform. When I was talking about AshaSoft, some of the people here would have got fascinated by that idea, and they will tell in whatever state they are working, when they will meet their MD or their secretary health or principal secretary health, they will definitely talk about this. If they are concerned about ASHAs, if their area of working is not associated with ASHAs, they may skip it. But if they are concerned that ASHAs are there, and let me tell you one thing, it is only 4 months, and in 4 months already 3 states have visited us, and they have said that they will follow it. And one of the state is from which we have learned a lot. So it was an honor to tell them something, because we were always learning from them. So things are happening. And let me tell you one more thing. NHSRC always, every year, sometimes twice a year, conducts a seminar in which these practices are shared, and replicable practices are encouraged, and even funds are given from PIP, NHM budgets. So it is happening. But you can say that speed or leadership or some issues can be there. A person in another state may not be that enthusiastic because, you know, he's following something. So I may follow my heart more than, you know, some other person's idea. It can happen to everybody. But there are platforms, and this is also a platform. And, you know, one of my person who is sitting there, you know, we have brought our ASHA soft brochures here. And we are sharing this idea with many people. And, you know, maybe by tomorrow evening, if this message goes to maybe 5 states, some of the state may show interest, and then finally, they may not name it AshaSoft, they may name it AshaStrong, but you know, something will happen at least.
So but that initiative has to be taken by the government only. So
yeah,
private
yeah.
people
but
cannot
it is happening.
Take
like Rajasthan free drug model. I'm very happy to say that, you know, now 3 days back there is a bad news from Government of India. Otherwise, it was always saying that, you know, we will also introduce free drugs and diagnostics. And you know, and their document said that we will follow Rajasthan model, and we were very happy about that. So, but now, you know, they have taken another line. They have reversed their decision, I don't know. But, so things get replicated. So we can say that a state government's decision was replicated by Government of India. What else you want?
Sir, one more thing, sorry, sir. Sir, like the Saroop ma'am told, like the people like us, fellow citizens like us, are very eager to participate into the government models and provide our services to the primary healthcare services. So we would like, if those kind of platforms are being given to us, we will be very eager and we will work upon those things.
Thank you. Just last question, madam. Yes. Can you just put here? Yeah.
I'm Dr. Bharti from Novo Nordisk, and I've been working on a project which involves ASHA workers from a pilot area in Bihar, that is Sampachak. And I'm very glad to hear about the ASHA workers. But whenever I go and talk to some government official about ASHA, because my proof of concepts are very, very sound, and it proves that ASHA workers can make a difference in terms of improving any health outcome. But whenever I go and talk to a public official, they say ASHA worker is already overburdened. Is there any plan from the government side that ASHA worker is recruited for a particular portfolio, like communicable disease, non-communicable disease, maternity and child health? Like, they also have a segmentation.
I can talk about Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, the job profile is clear. We can divide their 23 activities under 6 broad heads. So they are aware that what 23 activities are expected of them. This draft National Health Policy 2015 or 14, it says that, you know, they will put more things on ASHA. It is saying that. I'm myself apprehensive that how they will do it, because many of them are 8th pass. Some of them are postgraduates and graduates, but out of 46,000 in Rajasthan, 26,000 are 8th and even 5th, because, you know, when we did not find even 8th pass, we gave it to 5th pass. So I don't know how they will do all these, breast cancer detection and all that, because they are planning to do that. So you are right that, you know, when we put more work for ASHAs, we have to be very careful about that. We have to train them accordingly. And I think we have to see their educational background and their performance also. And one more thing I will say that, what was your first concern? This was your second.
Already
No, they are not overburdened in Rajasthan. Let me tell you one thing. They have 200 houses under them. So 200 houses. So in 1 month, even if they work for 20 days, they have to visit 10 houses a day. So in our case, we don't find it much that they are overburdened. Although for giving them much work or some advanced work, I think training has to be done.
No, all India level, we had a recent meeting and asked these questions for future of the ASHAs. So the definitely one is to make her a full-time worker, village level, like a full-time worker. The second option is to have second ASHA for maybe the non-communicable diseases and all of that. So both the options are open, and there is a possibility for doing that. And we did discuss the Rajasthan model of accountability. So we are all appreciative of that, but the same tool should be applied to all the people in the system. Nobody, only poor ASHA is the incentive based. Rest of the people, there are no incentives, disincentives. As I said, non-operating surgeons, we had 102 of them in Karnataka state, and they were getting the same salary as the people who are doing thousands of surgeries. There are no performance appraisals for the doctors. Their increments take place automatically, promotions take place. So when we have that system, poor ASHA has been grounded with accountability mechanisms. It's a good tool, but it's only 0.01% of the total health budget. So we need to have accountability. Same system should be applied to all the people in the system.
This can go on. I can see this. I never knew that primary healthcare could be such an interesting subject. I thought it's a very mundane subject. Nobody will come and attend this session. So thank you very much. And whatever questions you have, please share with us through emails. And we will definitely, if you have any specific questions to a panelist, we will place it to the panelist and get the response posted back to you. Otherwise, you can send it to Wish Foundation and we will answer back. Thank you very much.
I want to just tell one data.
Yes, please.
So that whenever some reference is made, you can use that data. In Rajasthan, out of 1600 crore of budget of NHM every year, expenditure on ASHA is 130 crore. So it comes to around 8 to 9%. So it matters. Mm-hmm. It matters to watch them. It matters to monitor them. I will be very happy to introduce an incentive-based, performance-based system for doctors if they like to get it. This is my answer.